April the 2nd next year, I would have been involved in 25 years of full-time preaching. I know, I'm going to get my silver medal. But I'm going for gold. I'm going for gold. When I started, I was enthusiastic and zealous. And now I'm absolutely passionate. Passionate. Yeah, I really, really am. I'm more passionate than I've ever been. And over those 24 years so far, nearly 25, we've been, it's now, I think it's 46 countries now on 5 continents, you know, working in all sorts of environments, in situations and communities. And we've endeavored to try and really not be static in the way that we communicate the gospel. And I hope something of that will come through in my next 3 sessions. One of my favorite verses in evangelism is from 2 Samuel chapter 14, verse 14, and it says this: God does not want anyone to be banished, so he devises ways to reach the lost. Whoa, what a verse. I mean, hey, what a verse. He devises ways to reach the lost. Not one way, ways, ways. So that's one of the things, you know, one of the things, you know, what we want to do is just throw out ideas and get people stimulated and get people to think in different ways. I'm part of a church in England just outside London. It's a charismatic Anglican church, and the actual church that I'm part of has about 900 members, but we've also planted 5 other churches as well, and we're into church planting and everything else, and we birth things and then we give them away. So I don't know if any, we've birthed a thing called Soul Survivor. Have you ever heard of that? Some of you, well, we started that and then we just gave it away, and we birthed a thing called new wine. You just chuck it away. Birth it, give it away. Birth it, give it away. You don't have to hold on to it, because if you give it away, God gives you other things. It's really exciting, you know? Now, I'm just going to mention, you know, I don't want to come across like I'm a real American kind of salesman here, but obviously, many of you are going to go to the bookstore. You're not going to quite know what all these things are. Now, one of the things, and I'll talk more in one of my sessions about evangelism, but so few people. I mean, if you want to learn to drive, you take lessons. If you want to learn a musical instrument, you take lessons. We're actually not very good at evangelism. But most churches have never taken any lessons. Hey, don't you think that's a little bit of a contradiction? Wait a minute. I want to learn to drive. I'm going to take some lessons. Most people in the church are not very good at communicating their faith naturally. They're not very good at it. And very few churches have ever done a course on evangelism. We interviewed 1,000 churches, and we found out that only 4% of them have ever done a course on evangelism. By the way, the 1,000 churches are all very passionate, enthusiastic churches. Only 4% of them have ever done a course on evangelism. What is that? You see, there's a bit of a problem. We talk about we want to do it, but we don't want to... Okay, now, it just so happens I've written a course on evangelism. Now, look, listen, it doesn't matter whether you do this course. Do something. Do something. You know, if you've got your own course, do your own course. If you don't like my course, write your own course. And send it to me and I'll critique it for you. Right, 7 sessions, leaders study guide, and there's a participants guide. Now, it might be, as individual churches, you might say, hey, look, let's just pick up a sample, buy a sample, take it home, have a look at it. Do we like it, not like it? If you don't like it, you've only lost a few dollars. It might inspire you, think, hey, we could write our own, or we've got our, whatever. Here's a little CD-ROM, these are free, that tells you about the course, so you can just pick that up. Okay, so that's the course there. Back in 1999, We're all thinking about going into a new year, new millennium, and God really spoke to me about preaching the Ten Commandments. I knew it was God because although I come up with ideas, I kind of think, I don't think I would have come up with that one. And all the years I'd been in church, I'd never ever heard anyone preach on the Ten Commandments. Just think about that. I had never ever heard anybody ever preach on the Ten Commandments. I thought, that's a bit odd, isn't it? So anyway, so I started to look at the Ten Commandments, and thou shalt, not thou shalt. They look they look negative, but they're not. We know they're not negative. They're positive, but people perceive them. So then I looked at them, and I thought, right, okay, coveting, what does that mean? What does that mean? Oh, how to find true contentment. Lying, what does that mean? How to hold to the truth. Oh, stealing, what does that mean? Oh, how to prosper with a clear conscience. Adultery, what does that mean? Oh, well, how to affair-proof your relationships. Murder, what's all that about? How to tame your temper. Oh, have a Sabbath, what's all that about? What's all that about? Oh, yeah, how to stop driving yourself crazy. You know, honour your mother and father. Oh, what's that about? What's that about? How to keep the peace with your parents, you know? So it kind of like, oh. And then I said to my pastor, I've got an idea, but I think it's God's idea. Can I preach the Ten Commandments? So, yeah, I preached. There's another whole big story that interlinks with all of that. And I preached the Ten Commandments on 10 consecutive Sunday nights. And I did them in reverse order. So I started with coveting, then lying, then stealing. When I got to stealing, I said, right, if you've got anything stolen, next week, come back. We're going to have amnesty dustbins. Bring back your stolen goods. It just came to me as I was preaching. Bring back your stolen goods. We had money. We had jewelry. We had clothes. We had books. Do you know, we've done this now 16 times. There was one place, one man put £102,000 cash into the amnesty, and we give it, all of it goes to local hospitals and homeless shelters and hospices. And then we get do adultery, and then they bring their partners, put them in the amnesty dustbins. No. We have an amnesty for pornography and things, and then we do murder. We have an amnesty for guns, knives, ammunition. Do you know, in one part of England where we were doing the murder one, there was so much ammunition, the police had to send a police armoured vehicle to take it away. It's incredible. And then when we do the idols one, they all bring back little fat Buddhas and crystals and bits and pieces and this and that and everything else. It's amazing. You know, one of my hairdressers, I noticed her keys, and she had a rabbit foot on it. I said, Mary, what's the rabbit foot? She said, oh, it's to bring me good luck. I said, Mary, it died. How could it bring you good luck? How's it going to bring you good luck? It wasn't lucky for him, was it? So we have an amnesty for that. Do you know something? You could do that. You could. You could, for 10 Sunday nights, you could do the Ten Commandments. Here's a book on the Ten Commandments. This will give you a starter. You've probably got 80% of your sermon in each chapter. Then you add your own gravy. I mean, that's it, isn't it? It's all about Jesus, isn't it? It is all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. You know that song we sang last night, coming back to the heart of worship? That's one of our worship leaders at our church. The one of the churches that we planted. It's coming back to Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. But so many people's understanding of Jesus is a misunderstanding. And it's so important to be clear on Jesus. And this book is all about Jesus. What's incredible is this. There are very few books about Jesus. There's a lot about lots of things. There's very few books about Jesus. I mean, just think about this. If a non-Christian said to you, okay, I'd like to read a book about Jesus, what are you going to give them? Okay, so you give them John's Gospel. Great, that's brilliant. It is fantastic. Okay, right, you're going to give them a book about Jesus. You're struggling to think of one. You are struggling to think, but I thought it was all about Jesus. And we don't have any books about Jesus, just Jesus, that you can give to somebody who isn't a Christian. that's de-jargonized. Here's a book about Jesus. Do you know, I give this book to everybody. Look, I keep photos in my Bible of people I met to inspire me to pray for them. Hey, where is it? I'll show you a little. I do. I give them, everywhere I go, I give these books. And I, do you recognize that guy there? I give it to everyone. Everyone I see, he's called Yasser Arafat. I gave him the book. I met him and I said to him, oh, it was so funny. I said, Yasser, I did not. I said, Mr. Arafat, I'd like to give you a book about the greatest leader and reconciler to be born in Palestine. He liked that. My pastor and I, every year, during our winter, we do 8 consecutive Sunday night movie sermons. And we've done this now for 3 years. We've seen more people converted. Well, we see more people converted in our church in the last 3 years at 2 different times. 1, Christmas. That really works for us in Britain. And 2, during our movie sermon series. And we've put all the movie sermons into 2 books. So you might, again, it's ideas, isn't it? Thinking about it. So that might be useful to you. Okay? Right, see what we've remembered from yesterday. None of us have got it together. Don't be too enthusiastic. None of us have got it together. Got it. Okay, what does J.John think ELIM stands for? Enthusiastic Lives in Mission. Okay, now, please take this handout out of your green conference brochures. Okay, the church. We're going to look at the church this morning. Before we can, you know, I think the reason I got invited to come here, well, I think that's what they've invited me for. But what I feel is that I will contribute something to you in the area of my speciality. You see, most pastors in the church are what we call in England GPs, general practitioners. They have to know a little about lots of things. Whereas I'm an obstetrician. I deal in obstetrics. I deal with birth, and that is the contribution I want to bring to you in that whole area. But we've got to start back with a diagnosis of the church before we can look at a remedy. Now, the church is about 3 things. Look up, worship. Look in, welfare. Look out, witness. Look up, worship. Look in, welfare. Look out, witness. The problem is that we can get so preoccupied with one of them or 2 of them, and we don't get the balance right. So you find some churches are worship driven. And so what happens is it begins to dominate everything about that whole church. Yes, of course worship is important. We understand that. Of course we know that. But we've got to get a balance. It's like worship, welfare, witness. It's like 3 legs of a stool. And what happens is we seem to get caught up into one of them over a whole season. That season could last a decade or it could last longer. But we've got to get a balance. Yes, worship is important. But it's only one thing. One thing about the church. Or what happens is we go through a whole season of, oh, it's all about, you know, welfare, and all the time we're looking at our little belly button the whole time. I've got fluff in my belly button. Have you got some? Should we compare the fluff and see if it's the same? Do you know what I mean? Welfare is important. Of course we've got to look at the people within the church. But it's worship, welfare, witness. You know, and in some ways, wouldn't it be good if the church was characterized by, this is not, I didn't mean this legalistically, but 33% worship, 33% welfare, and 33% witness. You know, in other words, get a balance between the three, and they all interfere each other. Now, over the years, Paul has his responsibility, as you heard a little, is to help the churches in mission. That's what we do. We go into cities and towns and communities, and I mean, most of our churches, you know, would kind of like involve 300 churches, 400 churches coming together, working together to impact a whole community. That's the kind of thing that we do, and we spend about 2 years working with these churches to help them. Now, what I'd like Paul just to do briefly now is just to share his diagnosis of what he has seen about church and share his reflections on maybe what could be the remedy. And then I'll come back and I'm going to take you through this handout. Paul.
Yeah, I'll go to him. As J.John said, we've been working with hundreds of churches through the years. I mean, the past couple of missions we've done, we did one to the county, the state of Norfolk, with 300 churches. We've just finished one in London, Clapham Common, with just about 200 churches. And all of our missions are characterized by churches from very diverse backgrounds coming together. The different denominations and the different styles. We've got, you know, youth churches, we've got sort of quite sleepy parish churches, we've got inner city churches, and every sort of form and flavor. And every time we go into a new mission, we're really trying to help the churches prepare. Because what we find is we can organize the event really well, whether it's a Ten Commandments mission or whether it's just a Christmas carol service in a shopping centre or something. The event is really, really easy to organise, and I know that you're all good at organising those kind of things. They're done really well, they're done really professionally. But the thing that we've seen constantly is J.John will be up on a platform and whoever's there to hear will hear, but sadly there aren't always the right people there to hear. Either it's all full of Christians or... Well, that's the majority of the case, you know, it is mostly Christian. And we've done various things as people have left the crusades and the venues, and we've asked questions, you know, through the Ten Commandments series, how many of you, of these have you come to? You know, and someone might say they've come to several. And how did you hear about it? Well, I heard about it through church. Oh, so you're a Christian? Yes, great. Did you invite anyone? No. And just trying to develop that further, did you know it was evangelistic? Yes. But you didn't invite anyone? No. Okay, next person. They did invite someone. And did they, you know, what was their response? Did they come? No, they didn't come. And you develop that further and you find out that often Christians are inviting their neighbors and friends because their pastors told them, you know, we've got this event coming up, invite your neighbors and friends, but there's no relationship there at all. And therefore they're kind of just giving the invitation and that's the bit that they've got to do. And so nothing comes from it. And also then the next time you go into an event, think, well, it didn't work last time. And gradually they kind of get, instead of getting bolder in their invitation, they're kind of feeling more and more like this is just a waste of time. Now, we've been trying to work out how we can turn that around and what actually the major holdups are. And we identified, I mean, the impact of mission, we identified four main areas that are key in moving people forward and getting people into these sorts of evangelistic events. The level of motivation is the most important. This is the level of motivation among the Christians. And we've found that Christians don't have a sense of urgency. They really don't see that actually it's very important that they do invite their friends, their family, their neighbors, their colleagues. And I'll just come on to that in a minute, exactly why that seems to be the case. Their confidence to invite, that's all to do with, you know, is the event that's going to be put on worth inviting my friend to? Is it going to be cringy? Is it going to be embarrassing? And largely we're finding churches now are very good at putting on events. I mean, we're all, I mean, take this church, for example. I mean, you could invite almost anybody to an event that would be put on in a place like this, and they wouldn't feel, you know, you wouldn't feel embarrassed by the level of quality. The network of unchurched friends. This seems to be one of the biggest problems with people in the church, certainly in the UK, that they just simply don't have any friends outside of the church. You know, and we've often got them really busy in church, so they haven't got a lot of time to spend with other people. And that's part of what calling out is all about. It's trying to let people recognize that they do have a big network of contacts, and they just need to be praying and developing those friendships. And their availability, again, to do with church more than anything else. Just tying people up in meetings makes it very difficult for them to spend meaningful time with people outside the church. So trying to work that into the church program. But the biggest one, as I said, is the level of motivation. And this seems to be mostly to do with the way Christians actually view their own relationship with God. And a little bit like J.John was saying yesterday about the heart, and you know, we've all got new hearts, but we have blocked arteries. And we've found that most Christians are probably in that state where they have blocked arteries. And that there's something, you know, they need to be doing something. I mean, in terms of the heart, in terms of the circulation, you know, you need to exercise. In order, you know, if you want a bigger athletes, if they want a bigger capacity in their lungs or in their heart, you know, they need to exercise in order to strengthen and expand. And we find that if we speak to leaders, they often do have quite a large capacity because they're always involved in the things of God. And they're excited and they're thinking about ways to reach people, they're thinking about ways to encourage their congregations. They're reliant on God in so many areas, but the Christians in their congregations aren't. You know, they're not reliant on God, really. Okay, this is a generalization, but they're not. So they don't tend to have a whole degree of sort of exercise that they're going through. So then what you have is, you on a Sunday stand up and you preach a very good message about, you know, what God says to us through his word. The abundant life that we're sort of reaching out towards. But the reality for many Christians is they don't experience that. They're kind of down here and you know, in the worst case, some churches try and say, well, we've got to make up a whole theology that explains why this is okay, you know, the norm is okay. So most Christians, we're trying to, you know, we at mission meetings, we're trying to get people to reach out to God. And most Christians don't feel like they're really there in their own relationship with God. They're not there yet. So they want their friend to become a Christian, but because they're down here trying to get up there, they're kind of working their way and they're thinking, well, I'll bring my friend, you know, but I need to get a bit more sorted myself first. And therefore, we have that's where the lack of urgency comes in. You know through your mind and through what you read in the Bible that it's important. People stand up and they say it's important that, you know, your friends find salvation. But the reality is, you know, they're almost uncertain. They know they've got salvation, but they haven't got so many other things sorted. So why would you invite your friend to a place of frustration? Why not get a little bit more sorted and then invite them to where you're at? So developing that further and trying to work out, why is it that people in the church know a lot in their head but don't really experience it in their heart? And how do you move that forward? And we notice that you know, when you have people go across to the mission field, I don't know where people go from here, but from the UK, you know, loads go to South America, loads go to Africa. And, you know, you have a little party, go out from the church, and they come back and they just tell you how amazing it was. And they say, you know, we saw God do awesome things. You know, we had this experience and we had that experience. We saw God heal. We had this you know, times when God revealed to us things. And it's like they've kind of gone into another place. And really all they've done is they've been in a place where they've had to exercise. They've sort of stepped out of their comfort zone and they've had to put God into action in their lives. They've had to rely on him. So really our encouragement to leaders is to try and encourage a similar style and approach, through church. Find opportunities where you can have your people in the same way that you do before you prepare for a sermon. You have to, Lord, what do you want me to say? But they don't have that. They don't need to prepare a sermon. If they do, then they have that experience of communicating with God. It's the same as a prayer. If you say, Friday night is our prayer evening, people come and it's out of responsibility and duty, and people often struggle to really engage in prayer. But if you're just about to go, I remember in Brazil, I'd been out there and we were going to go down into a favela and it had a muddy slope and there was a big black cloud coming, and it was right, we're going to go down, deliver food, pray for these people, but we must be out before the black cloud comes over because the rain will come and it will probably wash everything away, and if we get caught, we'll be down there and who knows what will happen. So it's like, before we go, let's pray. And everyone prayed. We really prayed that this would be a safe sort of journey. So again, if you need to pray, you can pray. So it's trying to put people in situations where they actually have to experience God. And then they get the urgency, then they have something that's worth sharing, and they have something that their friends actually can see in them. And just to finish, this seems to be very much to do with the style of leadership. Why are some Christians fired up and other Christians not? And in terms of leadership, in the Old Testament, the Israelites were saying through fear of God that they wanted a mediator. Put someone between us and God. And what they would do is they'd go to the priest and they'd say, here's our offering, and the priest would take the offering to God, and the priest would come back and he would deliver any message from God. And most churches we come across are still operating in that mode, where the priest is, he's the mediator. So therefore, their experience of God is often through you as a leader. You open the word for them on a Sunday, you provide a good worship group, you lead them in some prayer, and there's a subconscious kind of deal going on where they're not having to do some things. So you almost get the situation where really good churches with really good teaching can actually be a place where Christians recognize, oh, that was amazing what I heard this week, and I know I'm going to hear more next week, so I'm really not quite ready yet. So you get people who've been in churches for year after year after year who haven't yet, they're still, in a way, drinking milk. They haven't moved on. They haven't been sort of flown the nest and haven't been encouraged to. And we've been quite happy just to kind of embrace them and allow them to just stay in that place. So that they're really not that mature in God, and they haven't, the new Christian is fired up, and they're experiencing things like this, and they're having an impact in their neighborhood and their sort of family and workplace like this. The Christian, the longer they're in the church, seems to, often get a little bit more dulled. So you've got the mediator, and really everything is going through them. But if you turn that around and you have the encourager, where really you've got the leader, instead of at the top of the pile, is actually down the bottom serving, setting parameters and pointing the people into God, then what you find is they're getting their heartbeat not from you as a leader. So if you're a real pastor, your people will be very pastoral. If you have an evangelist who is a leader of a church, they will get that DNA. But if you actually step out of the way and allow people to, push people constantly to God, then they'll get God's heartbeat. Then they'll be real disciples. And then it becomes impossible for them, not to sort of experience God's passion for lost people. It becomes impossible for them not to want to grow and develop. The leader takes on an incredibly important role because, setting some parameters and some morality boundaries and encouraging people down this walk. And this is, there are some places that have been trying this out. To great effect. It's very uncomfortable for Christians who've been used to just sitting there and being fed. And it's very subtle things. It's like, you know, someone comes to you and says, Pastor, you know, I've got a big decision to make. I don't know whether I should move place and move jobs and do all this. You know, will you pray with me? And often the tendency is to pray with them and, you know, give them some advice and chat through with them, as opposed to saying, well, what has God said? You know, what has God said? Well, he hasn't said anything. Have you asked him? No. I don't know how to ask him. Okay, well, this is how you ask him. Now go and ask him. Now, when you've heard from him, come back, and I'll weigh, you know, what's been said with you. Our tendency is to kind of, you know, do everything for them. And then you as a leader become trapped in that thing, and you're doing everything for everyone. So it's trying to change things like that and just sort of turn things out. And we found that, you know, if you do that, then people, you know, people grow. People begin to become real disciples. And you become released more to do the real work of a leader. I'll just finish with this. Philippians 2, 12 to 16. Actually, sort of halfway through 12. This is Paul writing. And now that I'm away, you must be even more careful to put into action God's saving work in your lives, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. For God is working in you, giving you the desire to obey him and the power to do what pleases him. In everything you do, stay away from complaining and arguing, so that no one can speak a word of blame against you. You're to live clean, innocent lives as children of God in a dark world full of crooked and perverse people. Let your lives shine brightly before them. And that's, we had at the end of the mission in Norfolk, the organizer came to me and he said, we were having a debrief, and he said, my church was so involved in the mission. You know, we organized it, we had stewards, we did this, we served in every way, yet my people still didn't bring people. And he said, you know, how can I get my church to be more of a missionary church? And I'm convinced this is the key. It's not so much to focus on the people outside there. It's actually to make the people in our churches real disciples. And if we do that in the right way, you know, the impact will be enormous. It doesn't matter what event you put on. I mean, they'll be coming to you saying, you know, I've got so many people, you know, is there some way I can pull them into something so that they can take that step of faith? You know, so that seems to be the work, that if we can work in the churches and get them to be disciples of Jesus as opposed to us, you know, things will move forward. Thanks.
Great. Thanks, Paul. Well, if you were kind of engaged with what Paul was saying and you want to talk to him, he's here today, he's here tomorrow. If you want to take him out for breakfast, coffee, lunch, afternoon tea, dinner, he's available. So if you want to, hey, say, look, I want to engage with more with what you said, or I've got questions, or tell me what you've, whatever, he's available. So if you want to do that, make an appointment. Take him out and talk. Mary had a little lamb. It was given to her to keep, but then it joined the church and died from lack of sleep. So, I'm going to take you through this handout now. Now, this is, do you know, this is quite hard. I found this really difficult to put together because, you know, if you were told, hey, I want you to put a handout together to explain what church is. I mean, that's quite hard, isn't it? It took me a long time to kind of think it through. How do I put it down? And this is my attempt at trying to express church. I would say that church is a community, and that within the community of the church, there are a number of ingredients, 9 ingredients. 1, it is a community of prayer. Prayer. Now, it's very interesting, in Acts chapter 6, you know the story, there was an issue regarding the distribution of food, because the Greek-speaking Jews, The women were being neglected in the distribution of food. Now, here was an issue of social responsibility that was brought to the apostles. And the apostles said, this is very important, but it's not important for us. This is very important, but it's not important for us. So they found seven people who were full of the Holy Spirit. Hey, isn't that interesting? They didn't get seven social workers. They actually got seven spiritual people. You know, sometimes there's this kind of thing, oh, well, the people who do the work amongst social responsibility are not as spiritual. But the apostles found the most spiritual seven to look after an issue of social responsibility, and they said, we will turn our attention to two things: prayer and the ministry of the word. In other words, the apostolic priorities were prayer and the ministry of the word. Those were the priorities of the early church leaders: prayer and the ministry of the word. Now, evaluate your own weekly structure, routine. Is number one prayer? Can you honestly say that that is your number one priority of the week? Two, your second priority is the ministry of the word. You see, we're distracted. We're preoccupied. We've got so many irons in the fire, we've put the fire out. We're longing for revival. We're longing for an awakening. Wait a minute. What's my number one responsibility as a leader? Prayer. That's my number one. Number one is prayer. It's prayer. Number two is the ministry of the word. Then everything else. Now, wait a minute. Those two are probably the least in our schedule. Paul and I spent a day a couple of years ago with a guy called Juan Carlos Ortiz, who years ago wrote this book called Disciple. Anyway, so we're meeting with Juan Carlos, and so I don't know how we got onto it, the kind of his schedule. He said, I have one day a week off, and I spend 2 days a week in prayer. So I'm like, excuse me? What did you say? He says, I have one day a week off, and I spend 2 days a week in prayer. I said, what? No, what, really? Real prayer. I mean, what do you mean? He says, I go every week, and I go to this, I think he said Mountain Pool or something like that, and he says, I spend 2 days a week in prayer. I said, what, once every blue moon? No, every week. I said, but that only leaves you with 4 days. He says, yes. He says, I told my church, did they want a social worker or did they want a spiritual leader? They said, we want a spiritual leader. He said, well, I cannot be your spiritual leader unless I'm spiritually in tune with God. That will require 2 days a week of prayer, minimum. Now, that's unusual. You don't think that's unusual? But the thing is, you only have to look at the fruit of his ministry. See? Now, there's a big challenge there for us, isn't it? We are preoccupied. We're activists. But what's our number one priority? Our number one priority is prayer. Now, people like us, you know, Pentecostal, charismatic kind of people, we have this kind of, you know, we don't want kind of parameters, because we can pray anywhere, can't we? Wherever we go, we can pray, isn't it? We can walk down the road, you know, we can do it all. But you know, the thing about that is that it lacks discipline sometimes. And you find that, yes, we do believe in the liberty and the freedom of the Spirit, but unless you actually lay down certain parameters, you actually find a week can go by, a month can go by, a season can go by, and really, you're not a prayerful person. Years ago, I met a guy, I don't know if you've read any of his books, he's not He's an evangelical, but not charismatic, called John Stott. And he invited me for tea, like about 20 years ago. And I went to his house and we talked. And he asked me, did I pray? And I thought, you know, what a question. Of course I pray. And he asked me, well, how? What's my routine of prayer? You know, I was like, oh, you know, I pray when I need to pray. Because, you know, there's a lot to do, isn't there? We're busy. You know, what do you mean? I mean, we can pray when we get to heaven. I've got a lot to do. You know, and in those days, you know, I had the kind of attitude, you know, I'd rather burn out than rust out. So then I thought, well, I'll ask him. I said, well, what about you? Do you pray? He said, oh, yes, I endeavour to, you know, birth and undergird my life in prayer. I said, well, how does that work for you? He says, well, I try to spend, and he said it very humbly, very humbly. I try to spend an hour a day, an afternoon a week, a day a month, and a week a year in prayer. I was like, an hour a day, an afternoon a week, a day a month, and a week a year in prayer. So I thought, well, I can do that. I mean, if he can do that, I can do that. But, you know, it was very interesting. It was just having that model, and I thought, well, I can do that. I can do that. Now, you know, I'm not legalistic. I'm kind of, but it's actually been good for me to say, well, that's what I'm trying. That's what it would be really great to have as part of my routine, part of my life, part of the thing. And I would do that. Do you know, I would spend a day a month, every month, in a monastery. I did that for 16 years until I moved location and that kind of change. But for 16 years, and I put it in my diary, day a month, prayer. I get up very early in the morning, I get to the monastery for breakfast, and I spend the whole day in prayer, get back late at night. And I did that for 16 years. And I'd just spend the whole day. Do you know, I would only take my Bible. I wouldn't take books of other people's interpretation of the Bible. I'd just take my Bible, and I would just, on my knees, read and pray. You know. And listen, I'm not, you know, I'm only just telling you that as I've gone on in my life, I've realized, you know, I can tell you lots of methodologies. You know, I can say, this. And if you do this, this is what we've seen. But, you know, everything's going to be birthed out of prayer. You know, if I flew all these miles from London to here, to only tell you one thing, that would be it. Honestly, that would be it. Our lives need to be birthed in prayer so that what we do, it comes out of prayer. It comes out of prayer. We need to be people of prayer. You know, how can we mobilize prayer to evangelize if we're not prayerful people? You see, most people in our churches are not inviting people to meetings because they're not even praying for them. They're not even praying for them. Okay, what about you? Do you pray for your non-Christian neighbors, your non-Christian relatives? Do you pray for them? Can you see? We expect the whole world to come to Christ, but we're not even praying for our neighbours. Our lives, sadly, are not characterised by prayer. So that's the first thing that I would say. And you know, it's been said that you can judge the health of a church by its prayer life. Now, in my church, okay, we pray Monday to Friday, 7 a.m. every morning, and 12 noon, Monday to Friday, every day, 5 days a week. And we have a Tuesday night prayer meeting that is a revolving prayer meeting that deals with different issues every week. And it's a whole cycle, okay? Our church was a church plant from another church in 1964. And that has been the practice since 1964, and it's never stopped. Prayer. The whole of the church is about prayer. What has happened? That church was a church plant. A few people left the church to start this church, and then this church started to grow, and then we planted a church, gave it away. Then we planted another church, gave it away. You know, one of the churches that we planted gets about 2,000 people. You know, gave it away. Then we started Soul Survivor, gave it away. Then we started New Wine, gave it away. Then we started this, gave it away. So on one level, we could say, oh, you know, we're just a little church just outside London with, you know, a couple of hundred members. But if you look at the whole fabric of what's happened, but all I can say to you is, you know, 7 o'clock every morning, of course not everyone can go. You've got to get the kids to go. Well, it's fine. The point is, it happens. It happens. There's always people there praying. Always people there praying. 7 o'clock every morning, 12 noon, every day, Tuesday night, prayer meeting. Prayer, it is so. In other words, you're saying prayer is important. Whereas if you don't have it, but it's got to come out of a prayerful pastor. That's the thing. Number one, prayer. Now, when I wrote these, I didn't actually put them in order of priority. I didn't put prayer down because I thought, oh, prayer's the most important. And then I realized when I got to number nine, I realized actually prayer is the most important. Prayer. We need to be prayerful people. And it may be, you know, that, you know, we've actually forgotten how to pray, honestly. And if we have, let's revisit this. We might feel, hey, there's a bit of a block in my prayer life. What is it? You know, and this is an opportunity today, tomorrow, to talk to other pastors. You know, how's your prayer life? What's that like? Are you struggling with it? Are you disciplined? How does it work for you? How can we pray? Two, a community of praise and worship. The Holy Spirit inspires God's people and releases them to praise, which glorifies Him. This can be informal or it can be done in creative liturgy. Okay, worship. The church is about three things. Look up. Worship. And worship is so important. You know, our church, I don't know if you've heard of, have you heard of a worship leader called Matt Redman? Well, he was from my church. I knew him when he was 11. You know, and he started writing songs. And a guy called Tim Hughes, he's at one of our plant churches. You know, we're a worshipful church. Our whole church is really, but you know, it's 33%. It's 33%. It's not 90%. It's not 70%. It's 33%. Because we're about worship, welfare, witness. Otherwise, you become a worship-driven church. Okay, now, the important thing about this area of worship is you've got to remember the church. There was a man in England called William Temple, and he said this: the church is the only society that exists for its non-members. Just think about that one. The church is the only society that exists for its non-members. In other words, it doesn't exist for us. The only reason it's existing is for those that don't come. But sadly, so much of our worship is about us. So it's not just what we sing, it's how we sing it. It's what we do. It is, methodology is important. And often, I think if you look at what we do when it comes to our worship, it really doesn't enable outsiders to be embraced within it. And I think it's very important for worship leaders to always, you know, in their heart and mind, look, yes, I'm leading the people of God, but I've got to do it in such a way that it is accessible to people who are not yet believers. We want to have churches that are open every Sunday for unbelievers. Not just, oh, we're having a very special event and we're going to do the Rick Warren little 40-day thing and we'll get unbelievers. Listen, we want to be the kind of church that has open doors every Sunday. Every Sunday. Look, you can come any Sunday rather than, oh, well, you can only come and have a meal at our house when it's clean. Do you know what I mean? What's all that about? It's a bit like that, isn't it? We're going to tailor-make it for you. This is welcome, everybody, to our guest service. Listen, guests want to be anonymous. So what do? Right at the beginning of the service, we make them feel uncomfortable. So are you a guest? Put your hand up. because we want to give you an envelope and a tape. They don't want to put their hand up. They don't want to. You see? And we've actually got mixed motives. Because the only reason we're doing it is so that we can spot them, so we can zoom at them afterwards. It's not that we want to give them the tape. You know, so straight away, we're making them feel uncomfortable. And then sometimes, you know, yes, I believe in intimacy and worship. I do. But have you noticed we've now gone through and going through a whole season, a generation of singing songs to Jesus. And we rarely ever sing songs about Jesus. You know, so the truth isn't being proclaimed. And sometimes some of our songs, you know, what is that? What is that? What are we singing? You know, one of my friends is a mime artist, and he's mimed some of the songs that we sing. You know, I'm running into the Lord, and he kind of runs in as a mime artist and smashes into a glass wall, and you know, I'm a tower, and you know, all those sorts of songs. I mean, what's all that? You know, it's so funny. I was, do you know a guy called Phil Baker? Oh, isn't he a nice guy? Oh, I like him. I was at his church. I've spoken at his conferences a few times. And I was sitting with him at his church in Perth. And the worship people were all doing something like, what was it? I think they were doing, that's it. They were doing this, like that. So I said, what's that? And he says, what, they're holding up the Lord. Well, I didn't know the Lord needed holding up. Did you know the Lord needed holding up? So I said, where did that come from? So anyway, so he then, when the worship finished, he got the worship leader down. He says, what is that? Right? And then, well, this is so funny. The worship leader goes, I don't know. He says, we saw Hillsong do it. You know, so we all do that, you know. Do you see what I mean? It's like, why are we doing all that? You know, and all these non-Christians. They're like, what are they on? So look. Of course, let's be liberated. Of course, let's... But look, I just want to say to all worship leaders, lead the worship, not here. I mean, we're all Christians here. This is different. It's different. But in church, look, we want unbelievers to be coming every week. So bear that in mind in how you lead worship, in what you lead, why are we singing the songs that we're doing, etc., etc., etc. And I think it's okay. Sometimes all we do is sing one song after another song after another song after another. Sometimes people need a little bit of help. Now, we're now going to sing this song. Now, this song says this, and we're singing it because of this. Let's sing the song. So, oh, that's good. I didn't know that. That's great. Whereas it's kind of like a medley, isn't it? We're kind of moving a real long medley. What's all that? Right. Prayer. Praise and worship. Number three. Okay, community of belonging. The Holy Spirit creates a community of trust where we are committed to one another. Paul and I have got a friend called Barry Taylor, a really unusual guy. When I first met Barry, we got chatting, and he's the pastor of a church called The Sanctuary in LA. And Barry said to me, he said, half my church are not Christians. I said, what do you mean half your church are not Christians? He said, well, half of them are not non-Christians. I said, Barry, you're ever so judgmental to say half your church are not Christians. Do you know what I mean? It's not nice. It's not nice to say that. You know, just because you don't like them, they're non-Christians. Do you know what I mean? He said, no, they're not Christians yet. What do you mean they're not Christians yet? He said, listen, years ago, you used to have to believe, then you used to have to behave before you could belong. He says, what I've done is I've reversed it. I'm trying to get people to belong on the journey to belief, and then hopefully they'll start behaving. He totally switched it round. And he said, that's why every week, half of the people that come to my church are not yet Christians. I said, well, what kind? He said, we get atheists. We get agnostics. We get people of different religions. And what I say to them is, just come and journey with us. Just come and hang out with us. Now, that's very interesting because we often have, don't we, guest services. And the whole point of a guest service is to headbutt people into the kingdom. And if they don't get headbutted into the kingdom in that one service, then we don't quite know what to do with them. It's kind of like they didn't get saved. And it's like, well, you know, what do we do with them now? You see, it's the whole process of helping people to belong. Now, that's a fascinating thing, to be able to say to unchurched people, people who are not yet believers, look, on the road to discovering faith and belief, why don't you just come and hang out with us? You see, it's an intentional thing. Ah, my church, yeah, I can... I'm making a church where people can belong. Now, of course, they're not going to be part of the annual general meeting. They're not going to... Of course not. I don't mean that. But if you've got that as a philosophy, it will affect what you do, why you do it, how you do it. Belonging, belonging, belonging. Now, you've also got to instill that in the Christians. Because what's church like, huh? A Christian walks into the sanctuary, they see someone sitting over there, so they sit over there. Then somebody else comes in, they see that person there and there, and they go sit over there. 10 ravens in a desert. You know, we are the family of God. Isn't it? I mean, can you imagine, Luke and his wife, they come to England, they go, oh, let's go and see J.John. Yeah, so they come round to my house and say, Luke, it's great to see you. Now look, could you and your wife come in? I wonder if the two of you, if you could eat in the front room, because my wife and I, we're going to eat upstairs. And then when you leave, we'll shake hands. How's that? You see, this is where there is a sense of belonging. It has to come out of believers embracing each other and cultivating that sense of, yeah, we are a family. We are a family. But, you know, but being kind of sensitive about it, you don't overpower people. That's where our problem is. And I think with Penties as well, we go a bit over the top, don't we? You know, I've had so many handshakes from Pentecostals that have nearly broken my hand. I mean, it's a serious handshake. And it's like, not so tight, you know, come on, let go. You know, this is true, I've shaken hands with Pentecostals and they're holding my hand while I'm talking to them. Listen, that is not normal. It's not normal. You know, and I'm trying to move, look at my hand. Or if you notice, brava, and they, you know, I mean, a hug's a hug, but come on, you don't have to put all your strength into the hug. Honestly, at times I think I'm going to be suffocated. I'm only 5'6". So I think sometimes we've got to be like, come on, be a little bit sensible. You know, so you don't have to burst people's bubbles to be part of kind of, you know, let's bond. I think we kind of, you know, encourage it just a little bit too much, the whole bonding thing. Honestly, so, you know, just do a normal handshake like most people. You know, if you want to do a little hug, just do a little one. You don't have to pull them in, brother. Yeah, and to do that well, make sure you've had a mint, isn't it? You know, a little bit of spray under here, isn't it? Well, it's not going to be nice, is it? You know, welcome to the aroma of Christ. You know, all these little things matter. To encourage, you know, prayer, praise, worship, belonging. A community of healing. The Holy Spirit moves in healing. It can take place within the local church. Now, you see, people who are not yet believers have got rucksacks full of habits, hurts, hang-ups. Okay, so then we introduce them to Jesus. They come to Jesus, great. And they come into the church and they've got rucksacks full of hurts, habits, and hang-ups. So, you know, that's where we need to be able to help these people with so much baggage that they've got. And I think here's another word for you. Okay. Do you know, I reckon I probably know more about why the Elim church was birthed than some of you. Because I've actually studied it. Your denomination, your stream was birthed in a similar way to the Acts of the Apostles. Your whole stream and your flavor of Christianity is characterized by being ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Your whole stream, the flavor of your stream, is about signs and wonders accompanying the ministry of the word. That is what your distinctiveness is. Listen, get back to why you were birthed. Get back to it. Get back to what you're about. Over the years, you've diluted what you're about. You've diluted your distinctiveness. And often at times, you're no different to other flavors of Christianity. That is your distinctiveness. You're the people that should be taking the lead in the whole area of healing, in the whole area of deliverance, in all these. You should be the church. You should be the church that other churches, well, they should be doing it too, but most of them, they've not been birthed in that whole area. They don't know. Other churches should be saying, hey, you need deliverance, go to the Elim church. You need healing, go there, because we don't know how to do it, but they do. Listen, revisit what you're about. That's what you are. That's what Elim's about. Go back to the basics of what your distinctiveness is. Your ministry is a ministry of the gospel, of the good news, characterized by signs and wonders. That is your ministry. And that's God wants to use that to reach people. Now, we've got to revisit this. We've got to see, how are we integrating a ministry of healing and deliverance in what we do? Got to revisit this. So, so important, because people are sick and they need deliverance. They've let in so much darkness into their lives. The devil has got a foothold into their lives. And it's more than just saying a little prayer, oh, Jesus, come into my heart. Yeah, of course, come into my heart. Of course, come into my life. But you've got to take him down into the basement to clear out the cobwebs. You've got to take him out into the attic to clear out the bats. You've got to take, you know, there's so much more that we've got to do. And I would urge you and encourage you, take the challenge of rising to and revisiting what you're about. That's what you're about. That is what you're about. You know, listen, look, you take Bill Hybels or Rick Warren. They're called seeker-sensitive, yeah? Seeker-sensitive. Okay, and then on the other extreme, you've got people like Rodney Howard Brown, seeker-hostile. Okay? Now, I know, by the way, Paul and I move in both camps. I tell you, you know, I'm like the Queen. I'm above politics. And I don't carry cash either. No, no. But, you know, I know Rodney Howard Brown. I know him. I've stayed in his home. I've been at his... You know, I know him. You know what I want? You know, but the thing about being seeker hostile, I mean, John the Baptist was seeker hostile. You vipers, you vipers. I mean, that is not seeker sensitive. That is not the Willow Creek approach, is it? Isaiah walking naked around for 3 years is not seeker sensitive. Isn't it? Can you imagine I walked in here tonight, you know, now, you know, with nothing on, and I said, I'm just modelling what Isaiah did. You know, listen, you are Pentecostals. A lot of Pentecostal churches have become so Willow Creek orientated, you wouldn't know that they're Pentecostal. You wouldn't know it. Listen, I want to be seeker sensitive. I want a bit of the Bill Hybels, Rick Warren thing, but I want the passion and the rawness of God. So I kind of want to be, I don't want to be too much in the middle. I want to be over the middle, nearer to Rodney. Just a little bit, just a little bit. You know, I want a little bit of that. I want a little bit of seeker sensitivity, but I want the power of God. That's what we want more of anything. It's the power of God. It's the power of God. Listen, I'm not, by the way, pleased. I'm not anti-Willow Creek. I'm not anti all that. I've seen some. We've been there. We've been to Saddleback, been to Willow Creek. You know, yeah, it's fine. Look, you know, that's good. That's good. That's good. I don't think the Holy Spirit's there, but it's still good. I didn't sense the Holy Spirit there. There didn't seem to be any healing there. Didn't seem to be any deliverance there. Didn't seem, you know, we've gone over the top. You're Pentecostals. Well, start acting like Pentecostals. Okay. Please stand. Got the oil. Okay, what I'd like to suggest, we've got half an hour before we break. Okay? Now we're here, right? Obviously today, tomorrow, and at different times there's going to be different kinds of responses. Okay? But what I'd like to do now, I'd like to invite you, if you are a pastor, full-time pastor of a church, if you would like to come and be prayed for, then I'd like you to have this opportunity to come here to the front, and so that we can pray for you. Okay? Great. Now, the rest of you, listen, it's not, you know, what I want the rest of you to be doing is to be praying for your pastor and praying for these pastors. And just praying that they're the ones that God has entrusted to them, that the local church, and pray for them that they would be given a fresh measure of his grace, a fresh measure of wisdom, a fresh measure of portion of his anointing, to maybe reevaluate, to realign, to get re-envisioned, so that in this next season, the church can be led in the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the prayer. So, Lord God, I pray that with all my brothers and sisters, that that would become a reality, that each of these leaders, each of these pastors now would have a fresh anointing upon them, the anointing of your Holy Spirit. And Lord God, as I just go around symbolically anointing each one of them with oil, may you take this oil, just as the oil was used to anoint King David as king. It was like a new day, a new start. I pray that as that anointing happens for each of them, that they would know that they're being sealed for a new moment, a new day. And pray also, Lord God, that as the oil in the Bible is also a symbol of your Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit will bathe each one. And also, the oil in your word is a symbol of healing. And Lord, wherever it is that these, your sons and daughters, need your healing, pray that as they're anointed with oil, they will experience your healing, they will experience your Holy Spirit, and they will experience your anointing for a new day of ministry. We pray and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.